Hey, what's going on, guys? Welcome to another video on my channel, Hairlicious. If you guys are new to the channel, please make sure to subscribe so you guys are updated on hair loss and hair transplant topics, as well as current treatments in the pipelines. Visit my website at hairlicious.com to purchase your microneedle device, which is scientifically proven to stimulate hair growth, my low-level laser therapy cap, DHT blocking shampoo and serum, hair growth vitamins, and a few other products to help those who are losing hair. So today's video is sponsored by Dr. Ajar at Cosmetica, one of Istanbul, Turkey's leading hair transplant clinics in the world that specializes in DHI Sapphire technique to deliver the best natural looking hair transplant results. You can visit their website at cosmetica.com for a free online consultation. So today I wanted to talk about Callum Best hair transplant results today. If you guys don't know who he is, Callum is a UK TV personality star, and he's also the son of George Best, who was considered to be one of the best soccer players for Manchester United during the 1960s. Now, most people who end up getting hair transplants will resort to hair loss medications like finasteride, dutasteride, minoxidil, at the very minimum to slow down the further progression of androgenic alopecia. But actually, not strangely enough, Callum, he actually refused to take finasteride after his multiple hair transplants, mainly because of the fact that he did not want to risk getting side effects more pertaining to sexual side effects. As we know, finasteride is one of two FDA-approved medications in the US that's been around for a few decades now. And I feel like it's also one of the best drugs to slow down the progression of hair loss by inhibiting the 5-alpha reductase enzyme that converts testosterone into DHT. There are going to be a small minority of finasteride users, and this is backed up by, you know, multiple studies, who do experience side effects from taking finasteride. And these can include things like, you know, sexual dysfunction, brain fog, you know, low libido. But I will say that the majority of users are not going to experience any adverse side effects. Now, I don't know if Callum was taking any other type of hair loss medications, you know, besides finasteride, for example, like minoxidil or other treatments. But given that he did end up with a total of 4 hair transplants, I'm guessing that they either didn't work or he just wasn't on any medication. And even if he were on other treatments, if he did not do anything to target the androgens, he wasn't treating the root cause of hair loss in the first place and would have eventually continued to lose more and more hair. So let's take a look at his 4 hair transplant results and see exactly what transpired. So this is a photo of him before his first hair transplant, and we can see a pretty diffuse hair loss pattern with a receded hairline and also temporal recession. It also looks like his crown is pretty thin as well, but this first hair transplant will help reestablish his hairline, adding some density to the frontal portion. The hairline design looks pretty good in my opinion, giving him that kind of like receded type of look. And this is a good thing because he's already suffering from hair loss early on, and it wouldn't really be wise to give him a lower and straighter hairline. That would just be literally just wasting his, you know, potential donor zone area and limiting the number of hair transplants that he could have later on the road. So this is Callum after his first hair transplant. Hairline looks pretty solid, and it's definitely an improvement from how he looked prior to his hair transplant. The density obviously isn't going to be jam-packed, but I think it's a good start, as he had about 1200 grafts via FUE for his first procedure, and I think that it came out pretty decent. Fast forward a year, and Callum has once again decided to pull the trigger for a second hair transplant. So this is a side shot of his profile, and we can see the hairline better with what looks to be singles in the front, but his temples have been kind of covered up and disguised with his hair, so we can't really see what's going on there. But here's an aerial view of his mid-scalp right before a second procedure, and we can now understand why he opted for a second procedure. The mid-scalp area has obviously thinned out, mainly because he wasn't on any type of hair loss medications to halt or slow down the further progression of androgenic alopecia. And now he needs the additional grafts to fill in the thinning areas of his mid-scalp. The hairline so far is looking okay because, you know, DHT-resistant hair follicles were most likely used, but anything above the hairline, the native areas that weren't treated with a hair transplant, is still going to be prone to DHT. And as a result, Callum had to come back for a second procedure to fill in the balding areas with more density. The second procedure used about 1,250 grafts via FUE. And here he is after a year from his second hair transplant. And to be honest, you know, I think the results look pretty good. Hairline looks pretty natural, and it looks like the mid scalp has seen some good growth. So at this point, you know, it looks great, hair looks full, but we still have to realize that he's still not on hair loss medications, which means hair loss will most likely continue to occur as androgenic alopecia is progressive by its very nature. The other thing that I want to point out is that he appears to have some pretty good beard hair, and so if he wanted later down the road, he can also resort to implanting his beard hair into his scalp to add more density. Now, fast forward a year later after his second procedure, he is back again to the operating room for a third hair transplant to fill in more density to his frontal hairline. We can see some of the photos here that still show a lack of density and thinness to certain areas on the frontal hairline. And this photo here helps us better visualize the lack of density there is to the hairline itself. An important thing to note is that even after a hair transplant or, you know, hair transplants, the hairs that were transplanted can still very well miniaturize as well. We don't know for certain exactly where the DHD resistance zone is in the back of the scalp. And more often than not, I feel like a lot of doctors extract grafts outside of the safe zone, even coming across on the sides here, which means that the follicles that were extracted and implanted can very well continue to miniaturize over time. So this third procedure used up about 1200 grafts via FUE, and we can see the after results following his third hair transplant. And the hairline looks pretty solid, but once again, you know, I have to emphasize again that he is still not on any hair loss medications. And thus, this leads us to his fourth hair transplant. So this fourth one was performed at Cosmetica by Dr. Jarre back in 2018, and he had about 1400 grafts via FUE. If you take a look at this photo here, he's once again trying to add more density to his mid-scalp, and it's also slowly creeping up to his crown area, which I feel like is dangerous. And this is exactly what's going to happen if you guys are not on finasteride or dutasteride to slow the progression of further hair loss. This is really just a game of constant catching up, and without, you know, within time, I'm willing to bet that he will have to come back for a fifth, you know, a sixth, maybe even a seventh if it allows, to eventually fill in his crown area. And I would say that the crown area is going to eat up a lot of the graft. So with his fourth procedure, you know, he's had a whopping total of over 5,000 grafts via FUE. So he's really just using up his grafts, and he may need to resort to his beard hair in the near future. But as of 2021, he's yet to have gone back for a fifth procedure, and based on some of his recent Instagram photos, his hair seems to be doing okay. He has longer hair on the top, so it's a bit difficult to see if there's any further progression of hair loss. But other than that, it seems to be holding up okay. Now, all in all, Callum's case is something that I feel like a lot of guys who get hair transplants without opting to finasteride is going to experience. And, you know, it's very unfortunate because finasteride side effects can happen in a small minority of people. The thing is, when you're not on a 5-alpha reductase inhibitor, you're likely to continue to lose hair, which means you'll continue to get, you know, or have to get multiple hair transplants. But, you know, thankfully in my case, I was able to either stop or slow the further progression of hair loss by taking 0.5 milligram of finasteride daily, and I don't think that I'm actually going to go back for a third, you know, hair transplant anytime soon, only because I am responding well to the medication. But, you know, any ethical hair transplant doctor will recommend that you take finasteride or dutasteride after advising all of the potential side effects, and at the very least, you know, maybe look into topical finasteride. It definitely is going to lower the chances of you getting side effects, as it is applied topically and not ingested and metabolized by the liver, and you're going to be able to still reap the benefits of a 5-AR inhibitor that is going to reduce the conversion of testosterone to DHT. Now, with that said, you know, not everyone is going to respond to 5-ARs. There are going to be people who are still going to continue to lose hair despite being on finasteride or dutasteride, but most people are able to slow down the further progression of androgen alopecia. So I feel like it's very crucial to really consider being proactive, but at the same time, you know, for people like Callum, you really need to consider the risk factors and see if the risk of taking a medication that alters your, you know, your hormones is worth it to slow down the further progression of hair loss. I think if I were in Callum's shoes, I would still jump on finasteride because he hasn't tried it yet, so he doesn't know if he's going to get side effects or not. I just can't expect to continue to get multiple hair transplants and spend tens of thousands of dollars and know that I will continue to lose more and more hair. When clearly I know that there are medications out there that can potentially slow down for the progression of hair loss with minimal side effects for most people. Hair transplants suck, starting with the multiple anesthetic shots, which probably hurt the most and is probably the most painful part about the procedure. And then having to wait nearly a whole year to see the final results. You know, the waiting game is what really sucks. And let's not forget about having to disguise the transplant for the next few months due to the redness and the hairs falling out and growing back in, especially for those who want to be secretive about getting a procedure. But that's pretty much it for today, guys. That wraps up this video. Let me know what you guys think. If you have any questions, make sure to leave me some comments. Make sure to check out Cosmetica at cosmetica.com for a free online consultation. I will have their website in the description box below. Dr. Jarre, like I said, is one of the best hair transplant doctors in Turkey who utilizes one of the best highly trained technicians in the field. And I highly recommend him for anyone looking for a good reputable clinic in Turkey. But thanks for watching, guys, and I will talk to you guys in my next video. Take care.